Are we going to run out of 32-bit IP addresses on the internet? I mean, there's only so many, right? What are we going to do? I want to show you IPv6 explained simply and effortlessly so that you understand why we developed it and why we needed it so that we don't run out of IP addresses across the entire planet. The fear or the concern that I just mentioned, which was running out of 32-bit IP addresses, was not completely unfounded. In fact, with the limited number of IPv4 addresses that could be created, something had to be done to prevent that from happening. And that potential problem was noticed really almost immediately after IPv4 32-bit addresses were standardized and everyone started using them across the board. It was noticed even then that there's going to be a problem because we're going to run out of these. There's not going to be enough of them to go around for everyone to use to connect to the internet or the World Wide Web. The solution was to indeed create the IPv6 addresses, and they are 128 bits long, and with that lengthy number you can have this many possible combinations. I'm just going to put this on the screen here. I'm not even sure what they call this number. I'd have to look it up. You can probably look it up online or Google it, but that's the number of combinations of numbers that you can have with IPv6 addresses. And nerdy mathematicians, I saw this somewhere, once figured out that this is approximately this many addresses, this number on the screen here, it's this many addresses per square meter of the surface of the entire planet. So that should give you an idea. Now, a lot of the expansion of using up those IPv4 addresses was compensated for by using private IP addresses along with NAT and PAT for internal local area networks, with only an external IP address on a router or a router firewall having to use one of those assigned IP addresses on the actual internet. And if you'd like to learn more about that, I recommend watching this video that I created where I show you the difference between private and public IP addresses. But long term, moving to something like IPv6 is really going to be the overall solution. Today, at the time of this video was made, you'll see IPv6 used on parts of the internet already, but it's not extensively used on every desktop, laptop, and smart device that we have out here, at least not yet. IPv6 was designed to be able to slide into place kind of as a replacement for IPv4 if and when it is needed, and we know now that it's going to be a matter of when at some point. Now, more and more parts of the internet are beginning to use it as time goes on, and it may not even be visible to you. So I guess you could say it's conspicuously and eventually replacing IPv4. There are two major issues that plagued IPv4 that IPv6 is actually solving for us. One is that shortage of addresses that we just got done talking about. The second is an increasing complexity of routing information on a lot of newer routers and layer 3 capable routing devices that are out there. To make IPv6 addresses easier for us humans to read and to understand so that we can actually deal with them in a much easier way, they are written in hexadecimal format. Not decimal format like we use for IPv4 addresses. An IPv6 address is divided into 8 16-bit groups that are separated by a colon. You will often hear those in IT refer to these groups as hextets. Now, I'm not sure this is a standardized name that we're going to be using, but it's one that's kind of been adopted as more people use IPv6 on their different components and networks and across the board. They started to call these hextets. So each one of these 16-bit groups is a hextet at this point. This is an example of an IPv6 address. It's not case sensitive, and you don't need to put leading zeros at the beginning of any of these hextets. For example, in this IPv6 address, in the 7th hextet, the 03E0 could have been written as just 3E0, like this. Another shortcut you'll see used with IPv6 addresses is when you have two consecutive hextets with all zeros, you can actually replace those two hextets with double colons. So applying that to our example IPv6 address here, we would get this. Now keep in mind that if you do this, you can only do it for one of the double hextets with all zeros. You can't do that if you have three or more hextets with all zeros. You can only do it for one of those pairs that are adjacent to each other. There's one kind of exception to that rule, and that is on the loopback address for IPv6. The loopback address for IPv6 is this. In the case of the loopback address like this, with all preceding zeros, you can actually write it like this, and everyone should begin to understand what that means. In this example, the double colon replaces all of the zeros preceding the one. By compressing zeros like this when using IPv6 addressing, the configuration and readability is much easier for us human beings. Now, at this point, before we go any further, I would highly recommend you revamp and study up on hexadecimal numbers and how they're used. You seldom see them used in IPv4, although I have seen some subnetting methods where they use hexadecimal numbers to help you subnet, but you will see them when looking at MAC addresses and, of course, IPv6 addresses. The great news when it comes to IPv6 addresses is that you will seldom be required to memorize them or to actually know them like you would IPv4 addresses. In most cases, you'll have a DHCP server issue them out to hosts on a network, or they'll be manually issued out by an admin or a tech, and that's that, plain and simple. But for the Network Plus exam, you may be asked what the loopback address is, as I showed you previously, and you may need to remember that IPv6 addresses are 128 bits long. Now, I just wanted to make that little observation and reminder to you. Those are two things that you may be asked on a Network Plus or even a CCNA exam about IPv6. So moving on to the next portion of this, there are actually three types of addresses used in IPv6. You will have unicast, multicast, and what they call anycast. So just a basic explanation of those. Unicast and multicast are really the same as they are with IPv4. Unicast is used for one-to-one communication. Multicast is used for one-to-many communication. And then you get to anycast. Anycast addresses are applied to a group of hosts or devices using the same unicast IP address. They will all provide a service. If a client sends its data to the anycast address, its communication is routed to the nearest server that's part of that anycast address. Also, for the Network Plus exam, you will need to know there are different types of unicast addresses. There are global unicast and link local unicast. So just a basic description of those. Global unicast, these are the public-facing IPv6 addresses that are routable over the internet, the World Wide Web. The host has to have a uniquely assigned address on the internet to allow these to be used, much like registering an IPv4 address on the internet for usage. If you're going to use an IPv6 address, it also has to be registered and nobody else can be using it on the internet-facing side. You can think of these like you do a public IPv4 address. It's basically the same thing, only it's for IPv6. These public global unicast addresses will always start with a 2 or a 3 hexadecimal number. And then we get into link local unicast. This is much like a private IPv4 address, whereby an IPv6 address is assigned to the system and it can only communicate with other nodes on the same link. Now, a link in the IPv6 world is referring to a network or subnet or local area network or LAN. Link local addresses will always start with FE80. So you know what to look for both on the exam and in the real world. When you see FE80 in the first hextet, you're talking about a link local unicast IPv6 address. If you were comparing these to IPv4, it would be like looking at, kind of like looking at an IPIPA address of 169.254.0.0/16 in the IPv4 world, if you see an FE80 hextet at the beginning. Now, the major difference with that is that with IPv4, you never want to see that. And nobody ever wants to see that type of address because it means kind of self-assigned in the, if you're using Windows as an operating system, that means it's been self-assigned. Actually, with most operating systems, it's been self-assigned if you see a 169 in front of it. But with IPv6, the link local address is the actual address used to communicate with other nodes on the same network. And I'll remind you that for the Network Plus exam, remember the loopback address, this one here. Also remember that it can be shortened to ::1. Also remember when a system has no address specified, it will have all zeros with colons in there. Or they will list that out. The all zeros will be listed out as abbreviated as just a double colon. In the next video, we'll look at the different protocols used in IPv6. But for now, make sure to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already and click the bell to be notified when the next video is posted. And I'll see you there.